Well, Mem, welcome to Peggy Williams Bookshop. It's great to have you here. You're an old friend of not only the bookshop, but Peggy's, and given it's our 26th birthday coming up in a couple of weeks' time, and Possum Magic's 30th birthday. And we just noticed when you came in that this poor old faded Possum Magic was 1993, so we've had that hanging in the shop for 20 years, and it might be time that we got a new one, but that'll never be going anywhere. So thanks so much for coming in.
It's a pleasure, James. I was just thinking, you know, I've probably got a connection with this bookshop going back to about 1972, when my own daughter was 18 months old. And I suddenly realised that, you know, how important books were in her life, even at that very young age, you know, because I had thought, oh, I'll start reading to her when she's about 3 or 4. But she showed a fantastic interest at about 10 months. And it just took me a little while to discover Peggy Williams. And, of course, by discovering the bookshop, I discovered Peggy, who was just the most wonderful, supportive, brilliant, incredible bookseller, probably who's ever lived in Australia, children's bookseller.
Well, it was over 50 years that she spent in the trade. When
she knew more than anybody.
And was the first winner of the Pixie Award, which was a great thing, and an OAM winner as well. And
yeah,
she's just amazing, thinking back also as a child,
yes,
books from her from the time I was born. So, yeah.
Oh, I loved Peggy. I will have to tell your viewers that Peggy Williams really was instrumental in getting this book published. Wilfred Gordon MacDonald Partridge, which is probably my second, you know, great classic after Possum Magic. And the publishers were not at all sure about this book. They were not sure about it, the publishers of Possum Magic. They did publish it, thank goodness. They did publish it and never regretted it. But it was really Peggy who said to Sue and Jane at Omnibus Books, girls, you have to publish this book. It is astounding. And she persuaded them. Obviously, they edited it to their liking and perfected it, but it was she who persuaded them to do it. So, you know, I've got 1,000 reasons for loving Peggy. Rest in peace, Peggy. You were fabulous to me. Thank you so much.
Oh, look, it's just a fantastic opportunity to think that the 30 years have gone by, and so many books that you've had come out over the years. And, of course, with my boys in here this morning, you've just been reading your latest one, which is coming out in the end of October, Baby Bedtime.
Baby Bedtime, illustrated by Emma Quay.
Yeah, from Rudy Nudie.
Yes, the Rudy Nudie woman. Yeah. Yes.
So tell us a bit about that.
Well, Baby Bedtime is a book that I wrote when my grandson was born, and he's the only grandson I will ever have. So, of course, he's incredibly precious, and when he was born, he was only a kilo, and his arms were the size of my finger. I have photographs of my finger beside his arms, and his arms were the size of my finger. And when he was about 3 weeks old, I was in the hospital, because he was in hospital for 2.5 months after his birth, and I was in the hospital by myself, and I was talking to him I opened the little round window in the humid crib, and I looked at him and I thought, oh, I just love you so much. And my ears stick out. I'll just do that to the camera. I've got always short hair, you know, and I've got two different sized ears, and my ears stick out. And I looked at his ears, and they were perfect. They were just perfect ears. I thought, oh, I am so happy for you, baby, because you're a boy and you've got perfect ears. So I said to him, and this all came out in one breath, I said, I could eat your little ears, I could nibble on your nose, I could munch your tiny fingers, I could gobble up your toes. And I realised that I had written the first verse of a book, you know, that was just going to be filled with love for him. It's just, this book just overflows with so much love that I can hardly stand it. When the book first came into the house, I was so moved by the illustrations, which are divine. I just felt like lying down on the cold kitchen tiles and sobbing. I just wanted to sob. And I know I'm joking, but, you know, I did say to you earlier, James, that any parent who has a baby next year or any grandparent who has a, you know, a new grandchild, I will track them down if they don't give this book to their baby.
Yeah, and I said to you before too, it'd be perfect, you know, in a board book, and there's so many things you could do. Big book would be great as well. So.
And you and I know, because you're the, you know, father of young children, and I'm a grandparent who's almost a parent to our child because of our daughter's job. You know, I sometimes nearly cry trying to put Theo to sleep. I have wept, you know, between sort of 18 months and 2.5, looking after him at night. I've actually cried myself because I just couldn't get him to sleep. And this book, Baby Bedtime, which I'll just get, just hang on. Here we are, back in the groove. This book, Baby Bedtime, is extremely rhythmic. It's very, very quiet. It's absolutely passionately full of love and soothing and comforting. And I hope that instead of weeping, parents and grandparents will read this to their sleepless children. Just hoping that it really works for people.
Well, of course, we were both fortunate enough to have young children come into our families at very much the same
time. It was like a month apart.
Yeah, it was.
Yes, it was very exciting.
Course, here they are.
Very exciting. Really there they are bouncing around and both tall for their age, I noticed. Both of them.
Yeah, Jones
amazing.
Tall, yeah.
Amazing.
Just surprising given how vertically challenged my family is by and large, because Peggy was a 4'11".
She was tiny.
Well, I just wanted to talk about, we've also got the post up there, I'm not sure if it'll come out, about 10 little fingers and 10 little toes, which is obviously fantastic. There's another little baby in the world at the moment that's got one of those on the bookshelf.
Indeed.
As many babies do.
Indeed.
Perhaps you'd like to tell us about how the new prince came to get the copy.
James, that book, 10 Little Fingers and 10 Little Toes, was a beautiful book before it was given to the prince, okay, and we'll talk about that story in a minute. It was a beautiful book, you know, and it had been on the New York bestseller list for 18 weeks. It's been one of my hugest sellers. It's going to be one of the classics that I live and die by. But once it had been given as the official gift of the Australian government and country, the official gift to the new baby Prince George in England, suddenly it seemed even better than it was before. I don't know why it made that good, you know, but people just rushed into bookshops. It sold out across Australia that day. People went completely and utterly nuts over it. I mean, I'm thrilled that they did, and I'm absolutely thrilled that it was given to the prince, because it's a very sensible gift for a little boy.
Yeah.
It's a very calming, beautiful, you know, very, very short. I think books for babies have got to be very, very, very short. It's a very short book. But what I love about that book, for the prince himself, is that what it says is, there was one, this is just the first verse, there was one little baby who was born far away, and another who was born on the very next day. And both of these babies, as everyone knows, had 10 little fingers and 10 little toes. There was one little baby who was born in the hills, then another, and every single verse says, but both of these babies, as everyone knows, had 10 little fingers and 10 little toes. Which just goes to show that the prince is like every other baby, black, white, refugee, prince.
Yeah.
Every child in the world is the same. And I just loved it that he got that message.
Which of course leads into another story that you and I have, because not every...
Are you going to show us?
Yeah, well, I would have to, because most of the people looking at the blog probably wouldn't realise. When Mem first came into the book, I kept a deadpan face and told Mem that I was going to boycott 10 Little Fingers and 10 Little Toes, because not every little baby has 10 little fingers and 10 little toes. And Mem looked horrified for a start. But of course, I knew
that James had 5 little fingers. I did know. Didn't I write you a beautiful message in the
book? You wrote a magnificent message in the front of the book, which of course I've got sitting at home on the shelf, that I pull out and show to friends that have had new babies that I give.
Yes,
10 little fingers and 10 little toes too, and they all think it's hilarious.
You know, when I wrote 10 little fingers and 10 little toes, I didn't think about you, James, I have to say. I thought about you after the book had been published and nearly died. But I was walking on the beach with Malcolm, with my husband, and he said, you know, I'm very worried about that book. I said, well, you know, it hadn't been published yet. I said, what are you talking about? And he said, well, you know, I mean, not everybody has 10 little fingers and 10 little toes. You know, there are lots of kids born with 6 toes or, you know, with 4 fingers and what and what. And I said, look, Melky, you know, we can't include everybody every time.
Yeah, that's
absolutely impossible to include everybody every time.
And stories just wouldn't get written if you were afraid of offending someone.
Exactly. But the funniest thing was, I mean, that you know, were a favourite bookseller, you know, and offending you was the last thing I wanted to do, but you've got such a great sense of humour. I knew you'd be fine.
Yeah, no, look, it's fantastic, and yeah, as we say, it's had a real kick along again since it's been given to the Prince, but done fantastically by itself. And we were talking a little earlier about Where is the Green Sheep, of course, which, you know, I think, well, without looking, it's probably, even in the length of time we've had it, I think it's probably just about the biggest selling book that we've ever had through the place, which includes Possum Magic.
Yes.
And includes things like Dear Zoo, which, yes, you know, probably every household
massive
in Australia
classic, yes,
has got.
Yes.
And so it's just exceptional. I just don't know whether everyone realises, or you probably do, how massive that book has been and how...
It's weird, isn't it?
And how well you've done with, after all of the books that you've written, to get through to about, I don't know what number that was, probably number 30 or 35 or...
Probably about, 34, 35, something like that.
Somewhere on
your
list.
Yes.
To come up, to do a book like that at that point in time, it must get harder and harder to come up with great books.
It was very exciting. It really was very exciting when that book took off.
Yeah.
And because I'm so old, and you're getting older, James, as well,
yeah,
you know, we're all getting old together, but we're still alive, unlike Peggy. But you sort of, you realise that there's a generation now for whom of parents as well as children, for whom Where is the Green Sheep is a much more important book than Possum Magic.
Yeah.
I mean, if people meet me in the supermarket and are not aware that I've written, you know, 40 books or whatever it is I've written, and they'll come up to me and they'll say, oh, Mem, hi, it's, you are Mem Fox, aren't you? And I look at myself and think, oh, God, I look terrible. But yes, I am. Yes, I am Mem Fox. And they say, oh, just love your book. Book, okay? And now when people say, I love your book, singular, I know that they're talking about the Green Sheep. And I just look at them and I laugh and say, where is that green sheep? You know? And they laugh because that's the book.
Yeah.
That's the book of the moment.
Yeah.
Where is the green sheep?
Yeah, although moment, it's probably, 5 years old now? Was it?
Do you know, it's 9 years old.
It's 9 years old, is it?
Yep.
Really?
I think it was published in 2004. Next year's its 10th anniversary.
Oh, really?
Yeah. There's a big sheep convention happening in Horsham in Victoria next year. And they're going to have green sheep all over the place. You know, it's going to be the whole thing, sort of.
Fantastic.
But it's really about agriculture, you know. But the theme of it's going to be the green sheep.
Yeah.
I'm going to be there.
Yeah,
I wouldn't miss that for anything. I wouldn't miss that.
Well, look, ma'am, thanks so much for coming along. It's been great to have a chat to
you.
Well,
terrific.
And
I've been dying to do it.
And hopefully all of the librarians around the country that have a look at the blog and get an opportunity to listen to this will be enthused, and particularly when Baby Bedtime comes out.
Yes,
and
October the 23rd,
yeah,
people.
So that's great.
Yeah.
Because, of course, the at that younger level, it's still just as difficult to write the rhyming books, and you've done really well with that. My
Thank
boys
you.
Were
Thank
loving
you.
Listening to it earlier.
Thank
so
you.
Thanks for coming in. And
my pleasure.
Great to see
Anytime.
You
Thank you.
Cheers.
See ya.